I in fact consider it as an honor bestowed on me to deliver the inaugural Prof.H.M.A. Herath Oration at the University of Jayewardenepura today. Professor Herath had been a friend of mine for more than 3 decades. When I started doing visiting lectures at the University of Jayewardenepura in early 1990s. At that time, Professor Herath was a senior lecturer who had just returned to Sri Lanka after doing his doctorate at Carleton University, Canada. Later, he became the head of the Department of Public Administration, then elevated to the position of Dean, Faculty of Management Studies and Commerce. And on many occasions, he had acted for the Vice Chancellor of the University. So therefore, there is a connection with the university, some umbilical cord, which nobody can dispute or nobody can see. He was the live wire of the Alumni Association of Public Administration of the University, and he was responsible for recruiting me also as a life member of this association. Since then, both of us have worked together to promote the welfare of the students, to promote the academic curriculum of the university, and also maintain the standards in academic courses that the university is conducting. His life story is an inspiration to all of us. A young boy who had been born in a very large family in a remote village in the Monragala district in mid-1950s, who didn't have any aspiration to become a professor of the university, had risen to that position over a period of time, educating, I think, thousands of the students who had been fortunate in going through his studies. His school days had not been a very rosy thing, as many would have expected. It's marred with hardships, difficulties, and disappointments. Even in the primary school, we find that the morning session of the school had been completely devoted for gardening the school garden, and the studies had been started only after they had completed the gardening work in the afternoon. That was only for 1.5 hours. These students had cultivated vegetables, fruits, corn, and sold all these things in the market and earned money for the school. And that particular type of learning is actually different from the type of learning that we have today, in which we will search after certificates which would tell that we have gained a certain level of competence in society. So from a very early childhood, Professor Herath had been introduced to entrepreneurship by his school career. He had actually put them down in writing in his life story, which was published posthumously after his death. But I know when I visited him on several occasions, he was lying on his stomach in a bed without the ability to move even a finger. And he was actually sedated by very strong painkillers. So he was actually struggling between sleep and awakeness. When he was awake, he was dictating his life story to anyone who was present in the family who had to take down notes. And the memory of the man, even though he was physically disabled, the memory of the man is amazing because he had documented in a chronological way the every little thing that had happened in his life. Every name of people whom he had met during his life. And everything that is relevant to the subject matter he had been teaching at university and also serving at the university, the Postgraduate Institute of Management as one of the council members. So he had actually documented all those things. And when we read it, I find it's an inspiration to me as so the so what we therefore do today is actually to honor this Granda Homo, the great man who had served not only the University of Jayewardenepura but also the community at large. Therefore, I am pleased to be invited by Dr. Madhuanti and the Alumni Association to do the honors for Professor Herath this afternoon. I have actually selected a very topical theme for my oration, which is pretty much close to the heart of Professor Herath. The title of my oration today, as was announced by Dr. Madhuanti, is Religio-Cultural Fundamentalism, Liberty and Social Progress, which is pretty much opportune for the type of cultural experiences that we are undergoing in Sri Lanka today. We are all called Homo sapiens, a type of an animal who had evolved into the present status some 100,000 years ago. Then moved away from the original ancestral seat in Africa to spread to the rest of the world, rest of the globe, populating, dictating, annihilating, and capturing the entire vast resources that are available in this globe. We have become supreme animals among the kingdom of animals. The name Homo sapiens, as you will know, means man the wise, and therefore we are considered as very wise, intelligent people, intelligent animal. And one of the important things that we observe is that unlike the other species, which actually number billions and billions on this globe, there is a one important capacity which the Homo sapiens had acquired. That is the cognitive skills or the thinking power. The thinking power allows us to think about the past, think about the present, and predict about the future. And when this thinking power was acquired by the Homo sapiens, unlike the other species, we had actually asked three types of questions from ourselves. The three questions are, from where did we come? What are we today? And where will we go from here? And if somebody asked me to distinguish between a dog and a Homo sapien, the main characteristic I will attribute to the Homo sapiens, which the dogs do not possess. The dogs are not worried about from where they had come. They are not even worried about who they are today. They are also not worried about where they would go after death. Now, because of this philosophical issue that had worried the Homo sapiens, we have created a solution. The solution came from the religion. We all have basic religions, the modern religions, as well as the religions that are now extinct in the globe. Now, all the religions had tried to answer these three issues, these three questions. And today, if you look at the four major religions that we have, the Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, and Buddhism, there has been an attempt at answering these three questions. When it comes to the question from where we came, the three religions, Christianity, Islam, and Hinduism, they have only one answer. We were created by one supreme force, and as a result, we have to obey the supreme force. We came from the supreme force, and when it comes to the question where we would go after our death, we will go back to the supreme force. About the existence, therefore, the answer is that it is our duty and responsibility to serve our Creator. Buddhism differs from this type of answers. In the case of Buddhism, the question of from where we came, the answer is that it is actually due to a samsaric journey. We had been going through a journey of births and rebirths. Over this journey, we had acquired valuable experiences. And today, we are here because of the, as a part of this samsaric journey. What are we today? The Buddhism answers in a different way, and it says that it's our duty to live as a Homo sapiens. Remember, Homo sapiens is man the wise. So we cannot be man the unwise. We have to be man the wise, and also search for a way to end this particular samsaric journey. So where we would go after death, again the answer by Buddhist is a different one. The Buddhist says that if you are successful in doing those good things that would help you to halt the particular journey, you will stop it. But if you are not able to do that, you will continue to be born and reborn and going through the samsaric journey until such time you will find the way to stop the birth and rebirth. And if you look at the apart from these religious fundamentals, if you look at the modern science, the science gives also similar answer to what we find in Buddhism. For example, Charles Darwin, about say 2500 years after the Buddha in 1848, he came up with an answer which is similar to what the Buddha taught about say 23 centuries before. That is, we all have evolved into human beings, and we are evolving, and we don't know where we are going. The Oxford-born historian, Yuval Noah Harari, he has actually produced three important books in the last 5 or 6 years, which will try to help us to understand from where we came and where we, what we are today, and where we are going to after our death. He says that given the present level of scientific and technological developments, Homo sapiens will become a supreme homos. It's not the type of people we have here in this audience today. They would be supreme homos in the future. So what it means is that basically we are actually now entangled with some philosophical issue. And this philosophical issue has again created divisions, conflicts, and enmity among various people who practice religion, who don't practice religion and who follow the scientific one. And as a result, we are at the throat of everyone and we want to kill other people. And if someone is actually cannot tolerate what other people believe, what other people say, and what other people practice, that kind of a behavior is known as fundamentalism. And every ism is a sign of fundamentalism. Whether it is capitalism, socialism, communism, Buddhism, every ism is a fundamentalism. Even when we have this neoliberalism, it is fundamentalism. Those who are against neoliberalism, anti-neoliberalist people, they are also fundamentalists. Because these people are unable to make use of their cognitive power, the extract power which the Homo sapiens have acquired some 10,000 years ago. And when people moved out of Africa some 70,000 years ago, according to the Oxford evolutionary biologist Richard Dawkins, we had developed the sound system to communicate with each other, and we had only one sound. But when we moved from place to place, and when we reproduced ourselves by mating with other groups, we started to change the sound system, and that sound system has given birth to what is now known as language. And every human being today is therefore divided into groups based on their ethnicity, religion, place of living, and the language. But if you look at the language, it has one single root. The language that would have been spoken by our great-great-great-grandmother who had lived in Africa some 6,000 years ago would have been the common mode of communication that we all should have today. Now in Sri Lanka, most of us speak a language called Sinhala. Without knowing that, the Sinhala language has been enriched by a large number of other global languages. We have the root language called the Sanskrit and Pali. Then according to Gate Mudaliar W.F. Gunawardena, who wrote the Sinhala Vagvidya Balapayama in Sinhala, he had identified about 2,000 common words that we use today. In our general conversation, we have got them from the people who had lived in this country before the immigrants had come and settled down, who are called Rakshasas, Yakshasas, and Nagas. Because some of the very common things are pol. Now we go to a market and we buy, we don't ask for Neralu, because the Neralu is the name given in Pali for coconut, but we ask for pol. And we see Kotia, we see Kumura, we see all kinds of Vela, Del, also, all these words that we are using commonly today, they had been actually borrowed from the ancestral people who had been living in this land. Then two scholars, one is this Reverend Hisale Dhammaratana, who did the first honors degree in Tamil, the first Sinhala person to do an honors degree in Tamil at University of Ceylon at that time, in 1947. He has written a book called Sinhala Dravida Balapayama. Then we have this Professor Sadagomi Kopareva, who is a professor at the University of Colombo today. And both these scholars have found that about 40% of the words that we use in general conversation, we have borrowed it from Tamil. All the words that we use in commerce, unfortunately, have come from Tamil. When we say mudalali, padi, kasi, all these words that we use in commerce, they have come from Tamil because commerce would have been introduced to us by Tamils. Then we have the Portuguese words, the kamisa that we are wearing, kalisam that we are wearing, sapatu we are wearing, everything we have borrowed from the Portuguese, then the Dutch, then the English. So Sinhala language, quite apart from the other languages that we have in the world today, is a living language. It's a good sign because we are gathering every day new words from other languages and we are very flexible. And the language that we speak today is not the language which should have been spoken by our forefathers, say, 500 years ago. If you read through some of these old texts, Buddhist texts, you can't understand without getting someone to help you to understand. Similarly, the language which be spoken by our descendants in about, say, 500 years from today would be completely different from the language that we speak today. So it's an evolving language, it's a living language, it's a language which has been enriched by various the borrowing the vocabulary and the sentences patterns from all other languages in the world. But unfortunately, we have become fundamentalists. We think that Sinhala people are the best people in the world. We also think our country is the best country in the world. We also believe that the religion that we practice is the best religion that we have in the world. And therefore, we want to prevail upon the rest of the people in the globe, our own will, and try to become a master class in the world. Of course, we can become a master class if we have a more advanced culture. The culture is something which changes every day. Because if the culture doesn't change, that particular society cannot survive. So as a result, culture is highly flexible, it changes, and actually changes along with us. So as a result, none of us feel that there has been a change. Now, of course, I give this hypothetical test to all my students at the University of Jayewardenepura, and those who are present here may remember. Suppose we catch a man in year 1900, put him to sleep, and awaken him in year 2020 and release him just in front of the Institute of C. Jayewardenepura. What will happen to that man? I mean, will he think it is normal or abnormal? Because he might think everything is abnormal because the girls are wearing denims, they are walking hand in hand with boys, to their ear they are holding a little gadget, there are big, you know, vehicles that are moving around, and everything that he might find is completely strange. And for him, there's a complete destruction of the culture which he had been accustomed to. But of course, none of us feel like that because we have lived through that change, therefore we don't feel that change. So what is happening here is that if anyone has slept without being awake and without being aware of what is happening around him, he is the person who makes the complaint that the culture has been destroyed and therefore we have to stop it. And there is this type of, you know, fundamentalist ideas have been presented by these people. Now, we are now at this stage in Sri Lanka, and also it is actually very pertinent in countries like India, in countries like all, even in UK, even in, the, in Great Britain, Europe, Russia, where people think that their living pattern, living system, their language, their culture, their religion are the best in the world, and therefore all of others will have to subject themselves to this, their way. And this has spread throughout the globe. One good example has been provided by Amartya Sen, who got the Nobel Prize for Economics in 1997. In his book, The Argumentative India. According to Sen, India is a country blessed with diverse views. Indians are people who are blessed with accepting and tolerating diverse views. So that is why a person like the Buddha could be born in India and preach his religion, because Indian people were at that time tolerating some orthodox rebellious ideas. In fact, everything which Buddha had taught at that time was rebellious, because he was questioning the fundamentals of Hinduism, fundamentals of the Indian culture, and he was questioning everything. But Buddha couldn't survive and preach his doctrine because Indian people were tolerant people. But unfortunately, according to Sen, you cannot say the same thing about modern India. And specifically, when what is now known as this Hindutva movement, which tries to project that the Hindutva philosophy, Hindutva culture, and Hinduism is the best in the world, has flourished in India, according to Sen, mainly because of the Indians who have been living outside India. The reason, according to Sen, is that when you live in a different culture, and when you feel that you cannot get adjusted to that culture, you start developing a kind of love affair with your home country, and you think that the home country can come and salvage you. It's a kind of a romantic love affair. And those people are financing, according to Sen, the Hindutva movement in India. And they are trying to project that the Hindutva, Hinduism, and the Hindu culture has been the best in the world. And in fact, the Bharatiya Janata Party, which became a very powerful political force in India in late 1990s, overtaking the type of the secular political party which was there in India, the Congress Party, has now spread throughout that continent, and as a result it has spread to countries like Sri Lanka also, the neighboring countries. And the Bharatiya Janata Party, according to Sen, had distorted history. They have created new fake archaeological facts to show that it's the Hindu culture that had prevailed in India for more than 4,000 years. And teach the young Indian students that this is nothing but Hindutva philosophy which would salvage them from poverty today. And this has been very, actually, eloquently, this has been presented by Amartya Sen in his Argumentative India. And he had further elaborated on this in a further book called The Violence. And in that book he had said that all of us, we are prone to violence because we have lost our critical thinking power. Even though we are called man the wise, even though we have got this cognitive power which will help us to think, we have failed to do that. Now this university, University of Jayewardenepura, its predecessor was called Vidyodhi University, and the the unity song that we sang at the beginning of this particular event had very beautifully put this idea of being critical, being probing, and being challenging to our heads. So as a result, a university like University of Jayewardenepura cannot have this, you know, fundamentalist ideas. If you do so, we go against the very same university song that we sing at every important event in the university. Professor Sunil Aryatna, who had very beautifully incorporated the wisdom of the founding vice chancellor of this university, well, it is Isorata, who is reported to have addressed the first batch of students in 1959 and advised them that the university students should be critical, they should be probing, and they should be challenging. So a university like University of Jayewardenepura cannot harbor any of the fundamental ideas, because they have to be critical. They have to be probing. Probing means that they have to make judgments based on facts, evidence. And also they should be challenging everything that is happening around them. So the so what we therefore look at is that how this particular fundamentalism would have interfered with our liberty and how it would have actually impeded the social progress. Now liberty, when it comes to liberty, there's no any other person who had spoken of liberty other than the Buddha. If you go through most of the verses in the Dhammapada, you find that the Buddha has said that don't treat a person in a way that you don't want others to treat you. In other words, if you don't like pain, don't inflict pain on other people. If you don't like humiliation, don't inflict humiliation on other people. If you don't like being considered as a second-class citizen, don't consider other people as second-class citizens. So he, in fact, in many of the discourses that he preached, he gave the first ideas of liberty to the world. And the Western philosophers on liberty have actually carried it forward. I don't say they have copied the Buddha, but they have carried it forward. And if you take a person like John Locke, a British philosopher, he had actually presented the Buddha's version of liberty in the same language. He had said, don't harm another person if you don't like to be harmed. So that is the fundamental principle of liberty which we have inherited as practitioners of Buddhism and also as people who had been born and bred in a culture called Sinhala Buddhist culture. But unfortunately, what will happen is, following this Hindutva movement in India, we have moved away from those principles that had been preached to us by the master himself. So the liberty is one of the important issues that we are facing today. And when it comes to infringing liberty, what would happen is that people lose their thinking power, their creative power. For anyone to become creative, innovative, and contributing to rest of the people in society, you must have the freedom. You must have the freedom of thought, and you must have the freedom of expression. If you don't allow people to enjoy freedom of thought, people don't think. They're just like the dogs that we have in our house, the pets. When you command the pet to behave in a certain manner, without thinking, the pet obeys. And if you take the liberty of freedom of thought from people and ask them to think the way that others think, rather than thinking the way that we should think, The danger that we are having is we lose a whole set of generation which has to come up with new inventions, new innovations and new contributions to society. And that's why the founding Vice Chancellor of University of Jayewardenepura, he had actually very wisely advised the first batch of students, you must challenge what is around you, you must be critical and you must be probing. So that particular system of liberty is actually being is the fundamental philosophy that is being assured by generations of students at the University of Jayewardenepura, and therefore we should not have any grumble about being critical, being probing and also being and challenging the orthodox theories. Now we have a good example of the former Soviet Union where they tried to do this human engineering by getting people to think the way that the Soviet leadership would want them to think. A similar pattern we find in all other the countries where we have the dictatorial governments. The government will think that it's best the government should decide what the people should think. In other words, the government is therefore being guided by the fundamentalist in religion and fundamentalist in culture. And the government, in order to maintain its power base, they get together with these fundamentalists. So there's a collusive activity, and in economics we call it the agency problem, where two parties get together and they try to impose on us their will, but the danger is that we lose our ability to think. And when we lose our ability to think, in economic terms, what would happen is immediately, as a result of the central controlling of the economy, there will be a massive increase in the total output of the country. But we are not able to sustain that output because there is no new innovations coming, new inventions coming. And if we put a hold to the innovative thinking of people, eventually what would happen is we will start decaying, and eventually we will become actually subjugated by other nations who are able to think better than us. This is exactly what happened to Soviet Union. The old Soviet Union had a very good economic growth in the initial period of 1930s through central planning. But they went actually to an extreme, and as a result, the subsequent generations were not able to come up with new inventions. And many of the writers who had written about the experience of Soviet Union, about the human liberty, human freedom of thought and freedom of expression, they have found that one reason why the Soviet Union has decayed after about say 1970s was the absence of thinking people in the country. So same problem is now being faced by us also. Now our main problem as a society, as a civilization, is to progress towards a rich country within a generation. But all of us know, to attain this high economic growth, we have to come up with new inventions and new innovations. And if you are not thinking people, if you are simply following what other people ask us to do, what would happen is we lose our creative ability, and the loss of creativity will impede our social progress. Now when it comes to, I didn't want to use the word economic progress, I chose the word called social progress, because that is what Professor Herath had presented to us in two books that he has published. I will quote Professor Herath, and the translation is mine because he had done it in Sinhala. In the book on development administration, he says, quote, when taken as a whole, what is expected of development is the advancement of people. In other words, development is human development. It's the progress of the whole society. It brings about a change in the progress of society, and this human social progress should be continuous improvement. In this way, the final goal of development is the progress of the whole human society. That progress should not be limited to a few individuals or a small group. It should necessarily be an inclusive progress. So what he actually has meant is that if we don't have the whole society in progress, and if the progress has not been enjoyed by all the members of society, and that progress is not the type of progress that we should aspire to have. What we have to aspire to have is that a progress which would include all those people who are in society, which we today call inclusive human development. Inclusive economic growth, inclusive human development, inclusive education. We have made it inclusive for everything. Then he, in a later book, he has said, the material progress is very important for successful lay life. In fact, the availability of a bigger basket of goods and services, which we call the material progress, is important, and we cannot deny. Yet, the possession of material resources like vehicles, money, houses, lands, etc., will not guarantee a contented lay life. So if we are interested in having happiness in our life, the material things that we try to seek after will not help us to attain that particular goal. Then he says, in this respect, attaining spiritual advancement will help a person to lead a contented, successful life. So what Professor Herath believes is an ideology where we should have the material well-being around us, we should have a larger basket of goods and services for us to enjoy, but at the same time, if we haven't undergone a spiritual advancement, that does not lead to a happy lay life. So this is the basic thing that we call the social progress. The progress should not be a mere economic progress where we have the goods and services produced in larger quantities. It is a progress where we have all people in society, including minorities, including people who speak minority languages, they should have a coherent advancement for us to lead a good and happy lay life. And that is exactly what is being propagated by what we know as the social progress. So to have social progress, therefore, we must be tolerant of what other people say. Our brain should accept and should have the ability to store contrary views, the opposite views in the brain, take them out and then peruse that particular contrary views, subject them to what Reverend Velivitis Sorata had asked us to do, criticize, probe, and challenge, and then come up with our own views on society. Now this is exactly what we believe as the social progress, and this social progress has been impeded because of the fundamentalist religious and cultural ideas that are being propagated to us by people who are around us. And these people are actually creating a different type of a thing, because they are the people who will decide what we should read, what we should write, what we should think, what we should speak, what we should wear, and what we should eat. And people, human beings, have been reduced to not the Homo sapiens, the opposite of that, the pets that we have in our houses. Our dog will this actually do exactly what we say. He will think exactly what we think. He will wear and eat exactly what we give him. So we are actually being reduced to a generation of pets by the fundamentalists. And if you don't understand the danger that we are facing, the singular Buddhist culture that we think is the best in the world will become extinct in a matter of time. Thank you.